literally, like, we met in January and I started hearing voices in the June. So he was literally there from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're engaged now and stuff. Right. Getting married next year.
Whoa.
That was crazy.
So who should I feel pleased for, him or you? Or neither?
Both. He's very, but he sort of had, like, close childhood and that he's not had any
experience
with mental health and stuff, and so I think it was hard for him at first,
yeah,
knowing how it helped me and support. Yeah, exactly. Finally, have you got any plans for Time to Talk Day? I know that you said you're going where, South Africa?
Yeah, I'm afraid that I'm away in South Africa for 2 weeks from when it's happening, so...
But what are the plans for, like, NTW?
Obviously, these sorts of things, we try and always make sure that we've got some communication out there, etc., etc. But if I'm honest, and I'm ashamed to say, I actually don't know what the concrete things are we're doing this year, so it's something I will look at.
I found a lot of organisations, you know, actually haven't got anything planned yet.
Yeah. I think it's a bit different, because some things have got real high profile, like Time to Change and all those sorts of things. And I think Time to Talk, we've maybe got a bit more to do about it in terms of promoting it locally as well as sort of like more broadly. I say what I do think that we could do is trying to do again was that sort of market stall type thing that we had in the central town a few years ago. But no, I think on Time to Talk, we generally do a number of things to try and encourage people to talk openly about how they're feeling. But in terms of your point about getting people to talk up about their mental health issues, I don't know whether we've got much specific. But what's interesting is we're doing an awful lot around flu at the moment.
Okay.
And so what we've been doing, you might think, what's the connection? We're doing a lot about sort of personal stories, people sort of describing why they would take the flu jab, and what experience were there, sort of family members who had the flu, etc., etc. And that goes out every week. So it might well be, even though it's coming up quite close, that we can do a bit of that in the sort of trust bulletin that goes to all 6,000 staff.
If there's anything I can do, there is a funding bid, and I think for Newcastle Council to do an event in Newcastle. So I'll let you know about that, because I think it's with the launch pad.
Well, as you probably know, Alistair was one of our sort of governors in the organisation.
Oh, brilliant.
Good, good.
Okay. Yep. Oh, and Claire Andre, I think I was talking to her, and they're going to do some coffee mornings in local police stations.
I think some of those things will be happening, but they're sort of like a very localised level, so particular wards will be doing things, it seems, and so that's why I'm sort of slightly embarrassed that I don't know, because most of it will be out there in local teams, the things that happen.
But still, it's good that NTW are facilitating things like that, and it's good that you have your overall policy about being open, think, about mental health, and I think
that's starting to grow. And it's a really difficult balance, because we talked about, you know, are you comfortable talking openly, but what you've got to be really careful about is not pressurising people to think they're being told to talk about it when it's not right for them or the timing's not right, versus not wanting people to keep it sort of secret if that's affecting their well-being. Your point about working in retail, one of the sort of, I've got was sitting on the wall there, one of the most disappointing stats is that generally social attitudes are improving to around mental health, but the area that people sort of say that they wouldn't be prepared to tell people about their mental illness, the area where the percentage that would is the lowest is their employer.
Okay, yeah, that's really interesting, isn't it? I think maybe it's a fear of sort of being judged and maybe being looked down on and not given as much responsibility, I think, as well, like having the worry that they're maybe going to stress you out and it might make you poorly and stuff. And it's got to be a balance, hasn't there, between things like that.
I mean, one thing that while we're talking just come to mind is we have a staff survey every year where we sort of try and get staff views on what it's like to work here, etc., etc. And one of the areas is about discrimination.
Yeah.
And so it covers sort of age discrimination, sexual discrimination, all of that. One thing that it might be worth us thinking about is putting a question in about mental health issues.
Yeah.
Do you feel that you've been discriminated against because of your mental health issues?
Because
it's a national survey, so all the questions are set nationally, but you can add in your own.
Yeah.
So I just think that might be interesting. So it's been useful to, that's just come to mind in that context. wanted.
Brilliant. I give you the idea.
You did.
Mine.
You did.
Yeah, it came from me.
Yeah, it came from you. Yeah. Did it come from you?
Yeah.
Really?
Did you not pick
yeah.
that up?
No, no.
They've got it. It's on there.
Yeah.
It's all recorded, Joe. Everyone knows. What I was just going to say was about how you have got like this ongoing policy and stuff in NTW about being open and things, and I think it's so important that it's not just emphasised on one particular day.
Yeah,
like it's not,
I agree with that. Yeah.
You know, doing like this video for a time to talk day, it doesn't mean
it.
That
yeah.
that's, yeah, exactly. It's got to be all year round because mental health isn't just on one day, is it?
I agree. Well, one of the things that sort of slightly surprised me, not shocked me when I started, was when I sort of first spoke about my mental health issue as sort of a public event, how many staff emailed me to say, wonderful, marvellous, you know, you don't realise how much you've sort of liberated us. And I sort of thought, well, that's nice, I want that, but really, we're the Mental Health Trust, we've got so many people that don't feel comfortable about talking about their mental health.
Yeah.
It's sort of sad, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you're working in that field that you'd like to think and hope that people would feel more comfortable about
yeah,
talking about
it. Might come across as like, I don't know what the proper word is, but like being a hypocrite.
Yeah, yeah.
That you're pushing it for other people and
yeah.
for service users. But like I said, I think it's good that you've got it all year round and things. Tell viewers one reason why they should follow I'm Not Disordered.
Ooh, right then. Well, one reason why you should follow it is because it's great to read about. And obviously we need to get you up to a million.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, half a million is the next thing.
Yeah.
I should reach it in November.
Wow, really? And what was the event when it was at?
100,000.
Really?
Which was like 2 years
it's
ago.
It's only a couple of years ago, wasn't it? You mean that event that I was late for?
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, that
and
one.
You were meant to present an award to me and you just rocked in with your wife totally late and then wore a feather boa.
You meant to wear a feather boa?
No, your wife did.
I always remember that we were late, because normally, and it's my fault, normally events like that, there's like the first half hour, it's just sort of people
yeah.
chatting and we walked in and thought, oh hey,
we've actually started on time, yeah, some places do that, you know, you might not.
She's harsh, isn't she? She's clearly harsh.
Don't bring my mother into this.
Brilliant.
Right, yeah, it was brilliant talking to you.
No,
thank you for
so
making time.
Cheers.
Cut.
So how many other people are you seeing?